a pleasure to be here. I'm going to start this clock here. I've got two clocks going on. I hope to stay on time. Can everybody hear me? Is this mic fine?
Yes.
Too much? Too low? So like Sunshine said, I'm going to be presenting some of my research regarding extreme weather. Specifically, I'll be talking a lot about large storm events. So things like Irene, Sandy, Katrina, large hurricane events and large storm events and their impacts on water quality. So like you guys must have heard about tornado chasers out in the Midwest. So we try to call ourselves large storm chasers or tropical storm chasers. And that's ironic for a person who's dealing with floods and large storms because I can't swim. That's the funny part about it. So in this talk, really, what I'm going to talk about is the key premise that I have starting out is human activities have changed the landscape. We have introduced a lot of pollutants, nutrients, sediment in our landscape. And so we have a tremendous amount of supply out there of these nutrients. And what these large events are going to do, extreme weather events and large storms, they're going to increase the transport capacity of these nutrients, of this sediment in the landscape. The two combined together are going to create problems. We're going to have very large exports of nutrients and sediments, and that's going to impact our water quality. Whether you're in the bay or in a river or in a lake or a pond, it's going to impact the amount of pollutants that enters those aquatic systems, and it's going to cause problems. And we'll have to come up with more innovative strategies, management procedures to tackle these problems that are going to occur. And these problems are going to increase as the climate is changing. So in this talk, what I'm going to do is take you through some of these aspects. We'll talk about the extreme weather events and how it impacts the transport capacity. I'll talk about some of the human modifications that we have done to increase the amount of sediment and nutrients in the landscape. And I'll talk about two examples here. There's tons of examples out there on how humans have changed the landscape and introduce or increase the supply of these pollutants. I'll give you some examples of these large exports that we see with these large storms, some of them which we ourselves measured in our watersheds. So some of the examples over there. And then finally, I'll talk about some of the management strategies that can be put in place to tackle these large exports and water quality issues that we may face with these large events. So that's actually a picture with Irene, with one of the rivers getting completely flooded in the Northeast. So a quick introduction about climate change and how it impacts extreme weather. I'm sure most of you are aware of this. Human activities have increased the amount of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere, things like carbon dioxide and methane. These greenhouse gases are increasing the air temperature. Our CO2 concentrations now in the atmosphere have exceeded 400 parts per million. That's causing an increase in air temperatures. One of the greenhouse gas which we don't talk about much is water vapor, H2O. And that's also a greenhouse gas. It does increase the air temperatures. The interesting part about CO2 is it has a positive climate feedback. It increases the air temperatures, but with every degree centigrade rise of air temperatures, you have increase in water vapor, 7% increase in water vapor, or the capacity of the atmosphere to hold water vapor increases 7% with every degree centigrade rise in temperature. So it's a self-propagating mechanism that's happening there. What's happening is as temperature is increasing, there's more water vapor in the atmosphere. The atmosphere is steaming up. It's kind of a pressure cooker analogy. And that's where those large storms are going to get the energy. The large storms, the hurricanes, are going to get this energy from this increasing water vapor. And that's one of the reasons that, and you guys must be aware of that, folks have, the weather predictors, forecasters, have been talking about larger storms, you know, going up to category 6 hurricanes rather than going beyond category 5. And that's because of this increasing water vapor, the steam in the atmosphere. Not surprisingly then, our rain events have also increased. In the past 50 years, we have already seen that the most heaviest precipitation has increased in intensity and amount. This has been highest in the Northeast, where there has been 71% increase in the most heaviest precipitation. It's not going to happen everywhere. In the Southwest, actually, it may be the increase is much less compared to the Northeast. Not surprisingly, again, we have been getting many of these large storms, one after another. And I can name them. You know, you have Nicole, which we had around Deleware in 2010. Then we had Irene, Tropical Storm Lee, immediately after Irene, Hurricane Sandy, Andrea, and there was an unnamed storm that happened. And then we had Hurricane Matthew. And that really caused problems in North Carolina and South Carolina. Fortunately for us, we weren't able to sample Hurricane Matthew, but we did get all of these events in our watershed, and we sampled the water quality associated with these events. And it really provides some really good insights on how things change, how the water chemistry, how the water quality changes with these large events. Stream flow is increasing across the US, not everywhere. Again, because of this increased wetness, increased large storms, there's an increasing trend in stream flow and discharge in the Northeast and the Midwest, but not so in the Southwest. In the Southwest, things are getting more drier. So they're going to have more water problems out in the Southwest, as opposed to us over here in the Northeast and the Mid-Atlantic. We're also going to get more droughts. That's kind of contradictory over there, that we're going to get very large events as well as droughts, but what's going to happen is between these large events, there are going to be more drier periods. And that's happening pretty much across the country. Again, worse in the Southwest, but we're going to see more drought conditions also along the East Coast. So there's going to be more climate variability that's going to be happening. It may happen during winter also. We had this weird, crazy winter, which you guys must remember, from 2016, globally the most warmest winter on record, the winter of 2016. It was very warm in Delaware also, but we did get some very cold snaps associated with the polar vortex coming down. So you have these nice 50 degree days in February or so, really warm conditions, and then the polar vortex comes down. And then you have about minus 15 Fahrenheit for a few days. It's crazy. But there's a really interesting implication of that for water quality and watersheds. I'll talk about that later. That this winter climate variability is going to affect water quality. You won't expect that, but it is going to show up in some of these watersheds. And I'm going to give you some examples. So one other thing which I want to mention is, it's not just the largest storms that cause all the problems. You could also have smaller storms, smaller than some of the very large hurricanes that we talk about. But there could be other conditions that are happening that may magnify that event. Like, for example, let me give you an example for Irene. Irene was on record not the largest storm in the Northeast and in some locations. It didn't drop as much rain as some of the previous large events that have happened historically. But Irene did cause a lot of flooding, especially in Vermont and parts of Connecticut. There was a lot of flooding and record flooding, record erosion. Why? Because the conditions, the time, or the summer before Irene came was very wet. So what happened was the landscape was wet, it couldn't take in more rainfall, and when Irene came, it was saturated, didn't have the capacity to accept more rain, and you got flooding. And we had a paper discussing that with the Metcalf group. So these are the challenges, you know, is how do we define extreme events? I've used the term extreme events here. I recently had organized a conference in Puerto Rico to talk about extreme events and their impacts on aquatic systems. One of the big questions that we had there is, how do we define extreme events? Do we define them based on the size of the event, like amount of rainfall that fell, or the impact of the event? Like how much flooding was there, how many people were impacted, what was the impact on the water quality, what happened to the aquatic ecosystems and the habitat. So do we define them in terms of the size of the event or the ecosystem response? So that's the great question which we are still trying to wrap our heads around and kind of get an answer to that. That paper I mentioned about, the issue of, about Irene in the Northeast was really nicely elaborated on this paper, which said that it was the antecedent wetness and not necessarily the size of the event itself that contributed to the flooding. So it's pretty complex things, and the reason why it was wet is because we got more rainfall throughout that year in 2011. And climate change predicts that's going to happen in the future, especially for the Northeast. You're going to have more annual rainfall, more wet conditions, and then on top of that, you might get these large storms. Here's some other coupled conditions that may happen. So these coupled conditions may cause greater impacts. Like for example, out in the Southwest, so this was in New Mexico by a professor out there who did this study. There was drought conditions that led to forest fires, and those forest fires coupled with a very large rainfall event caused this situation where the water went from this clarity to this clarity over here. So there are coupled conditions that could happen with these large events that could cause these problems. Freeze thaw conditions, again, not very apparent, not very obvious, that what's freeze thaw got to do with large events and water quality. I'm going to show you an example on how freeze thaw conditions, and these might happen with the polar vortex coming down. So the polar vortex coming down, going back up again, the more cycles it does, the more freeze thaw conditions you might get, and it might impact the water quality that you might see during the winter. So I mentioned about the supply in the landscape. We have increased the amount of nutrients, pollutants, sediments in the landscape. This supply is sitting there because of human activities. I'm going to give you two examples, one from the current era and one from the colonial era. So these two examples are, the really interesting example from the colonial era is the mill ponds that were created, the mills that were created all along the eastern coast. And how they impacted the aquatic ecosystems, our streams, our rivers, and the amount of sediment that's sitting there. Our valley bottoms in the Northeast, especially in the Piedmont, are chock full of sediments. Why? Because of mill dams. I'll get to that in a minute. More contemporary, more current situation that we're causing the problem is in the Delmarva Peninsula, in the Delaware, Maryland, and Virginia area, where we are applying animal manure like crazy. And that's saturating our soils with phosphorus. And that's going to leach out. So I'm going to elaborate on both these examples. So this was a groundbreaking paper, a classic paper by Dorothy Merritt and Bob Walter. So Bob Walter and Dorothy Merritt, they're at Franklin and Marshall in Pennsylvania. What they found was, and it's amazing that this paper came out in 2008 and not before. And how people did, so they made the connection between the very large deposits of sediments in the streams in the Piedmont and the mill dams that were there. So what they said, there were large amount of mill dams on rivers and tributaries in the Northeast, and this was all across the eastern seaboard, from the Mid-Atlantic to the Northeast up into Rhode Island and down into Georgia. So there were tremendous amount of these mill dams along these tributaries. These dams were as close as a mile apart. So essentially what we had done 200 years back is converted our streams and rivers into these slack water ponds because of these mill dams being spaced apart every mile or so. I'll give you some examples of there. And at the same time, there was extensive agricultural erosion that was happening. So the extensive agriculture erosion coupled with these mill dams, which backed up the water, led to our valley bottoms going from this to this. So this is where the mill dam was. That was the top of the mill dam. So the mill dam was sitting there, backing up the water and the sediment behind it. But what has happened recently is these mill dams have breached, are breaking, some have already breached, some are still there, some are being broken down now because to improve the habitat aspect. So what is happening is these streams now are cutting down through the mill deposit, the fine-grained mill sediment. But below that you can, so this work has been done by Dorothy Meritz and Bob Walter, and they describe that in their paper. You can actually see the pre-colonial sediment in these stream banks. You can see the black layer that was there 300 years back, which was thousands of years old. You can actually find Native American artifacts in there, in that black layer. You can, if you're very lucky, you might be able to find a mammoth tooth down in this gravel layer. But you really have to be very lucky for that. This is what has happened now. This is what our streams look like through these mill pond deposits. So we have a lot of sediment sitting there, which the stream is cutting through, and it's eroding the sediment. With that sediment, you have nutrients also there, sitting there. Again, depending on what type of watershed you are in, whether you're in an agricultural system or in a forested system. So this, what I'm trying to get at here is there's tremendous amount of supply that is sitting back in these streams. The sediment is there. If the water comes in with greater velocity, greater force, greater volume, all this sediment is going to come out. It's going to go down to your bays. It's going to go into the Delaware Bay. It's going to go down into the Chesapeake Bay. And it's going to create problems in the Chesapeake Bay. So the Chesapeake Bay is really concerned about this, about the legacy sediments and its impacts on the water quality in the Chesapeake Bay. This is our study site here in Maryland. And actually, this is a map from 1877. And we're looking for more like maps like this, because they show you where the mill dams were. So this is a map from 1877. And it shows you all the mill dams that were there and the mills that were associated with it. And what you can do is go to these streams and you can actually see exactly at the location, depending on when the mill dam was breached, you can see the stream banks. You can see the legacy sediments there, still now out there, and they're slowly getting eroded. So here's an example from our watershed. There's the mill dam. And again, these dams are not huge. They're like anywhere from 3 feet high to 10 feet high, made of stones. These were used for mills to back up the water and use the mill dam to generate energy to run the mills, the water energy. So if you go back and look at the sediments or the stream banks behind these mill dams, this is what you look at. This is what you see. Lots of sediment sitting out there, ready to be eroded with the next big storm. So the supply is there. The other thing that we're doing more currently, especially in Delmarva, is because we have a very large poultry industry in Delmarva. There's more chickens on the Delmarva Peninsula than humans. On the eastern shore of Maryland, there are 600 chickens per human. This is all to satisfy the demand of the poultry industry. So, especially in Sussex County here, Sussex County is the number one county in terms of poultry production per capita in the nation. So there's a tremendous amount of chickens. With that comes the poop, and it stays in Delmarva itself. So all that poop or manure is being applied mostly in the Delmarva Peninsula, and it has been being applied since the past 15 to 20 years. And it's getting saturated, the soils are getting saturated. Why? Especially with phosphorus. Why? Because the manure, chicken manure, has a ratio of nitrogen to phosphorus of 3:1. The crop needs 8:1, 8 parts of nitrogen, 1 part of phosphorus. But when you apply this poop for this demand, you're going to apply more nitrogen, or you end up applying more phosphorus to meet the nitrogen demands. And phosphorus sits there. phosphorus gets bound up with the soil, surficial soil, and it just sits there. It will be taken up by the crops, but then you still have very high concentrations of phosphorus. And that's what is happening in the Delmarva region, in Delaware and Maryland. Our surficial soils are getting saturated with phosphorus every year that we put more and more manure. So our surficial soils are saturated with phosphorus, and when you have a very large storm event, like a Hurricane Irene or any other large rainfall event, if you have a lot of surface runoff, all that phosphorus that's sitting in the surficial layers is going to get washed out. By the way, this is a picture of one of my students next to a manure pile. That manure pile was getting ready to be applied on the field. So he wasn't pretty happy about taking samples because the pile was stinking pretty bad. So what is happening is we have generated a lot of supply, and the large storms are going to provide the transport capacity, and therefore we're going to see more watershed exports. We're going to see higher exports of these sediments and nutrients coming down the rivers, the streams, and eventually into the bay. So that's the Chesapeake Bay after Tropical Storm Lee. So Tropical Storm Lee happened just after Irene, like at a few days after Irene, and the sediment plume from the Susquehanna River could be seen via satellite pictures. So this is a satellite picture of the Chesapeake Bay. And we have sampled some of these streams and rivers after this very large events. For example, this was the scene after, not Irene, but there was another large storm that happened in 2014. We got about, this happened in April or May 1, 2014. We got about 6 inches of rainfall over a 24 to 48 hour period. And we had a lot of flooding, a lot of sediment moving. And again, so this is the landscape that has the mill pond legacy sediments. So that's why you're starting to see a lot of these sediments, the legacy sediments that are sitting on the banks are getting eroded and getting flushed down these rivers and streams. And some of it is getting deposited again through the stream network. So what we have done is we have monitored some of these large events just to find out, hey, so what's happening? How much material does these large events move? What is the magnitude that we're looking at? So we were lucky to monitor Hurricane Irene and the flooding after that. And we found that, so this was a small stream. So what we have done is to, you know, keep all our bases covered. We are monitoring small streams as well as large streams. The problem with large streams is when you have these very large events, it's very difficult to get to them or sample them. Sometimes your monitoring equipment is gone. It's with the floods, it's just completely washed out. So some of these small streams then help out, because the small streams do flood, but again, it's not as big in magnitude in terms of sampling. So this is one of our sites in Maryland, where we found that in 59 hours, in just 59 hours, Hurricane Irene moved nearly half the annual carbon flux. So the annual total, half of it moved in just 59 hours after Irene. So just imagine that you were not sampling Hurricane Irene, that you were out in your home, getting away from the rain and the floods, and you did not sample this. You essentially missed half the picture. So this was for organic carbon, because that's one of the chemicals that or solutes that we're looking at. But this is the picture for total nitrogen. That one third of the annual export happened in just 59 hours after Irene. And this stream drains directly into the Chesapeake Bay. So all this material is going into the Chesapeake Bay. And it's going to go into the Chesapeake Bay and then decay or decompose there and affect the water quality of the Chesapeake Bay. So monitoring such large events or storm events is extremely important. If you don't monitor these large events, you're going to miss nearly half the picture in terms of organic carbon. What we also found is not only just, and this might be a little bit more technical, but what we found also that not just the amount, but the type of material that's moving also changes. So during regular small events, the finer fractions of organic matter, the dissolved fractions of nitrogen, are the dominant fraction. But when you go to these very large events, it's the larger fractions of the organic matter, larger sediment fractions or sediment sizes are the ones that are getting flushed down the system. So your regime, your water quality regime is changing. And why? Because of the more energy associated with these large events. Because of the flooding, there's more energy in the water and it's eroding these large particles. And it's moving these large particles into the streams, into the rivers, ponds, lakes, the bay. And these large particles will have a greater impact for a longer duration, as opposed to the more finer particles. So your regime is also changing. Your type of water quality problem that you face is also changing. Not just the amount, the total amount that changes. And like I said, we are studying small streams, we are studying large streams. Fortunately, this wasn't what we had to sample, but the Susquehanna River contributes 50% of the flow to the Chesapeake Bay. Tremendously large river here. And what we found was with Tropical Storm Lee, which happened immediately after Irene, it moved 19 million tons of sediment in a few days. 19 million tons. That was only second to the other very big hurricane that happened in 72, Hurricane Agnes, which moved 30 million tons. And these large events can impact the system for many, many years. And that's what happened with Agnes. Agnes completely changed the Chesapeake Bay response for a few years. Because you're getting 10 to 25 years worth of sediment in a few days. This is the annual, this is the typical annual flux, 1.5 million tons. With these large events, you're going to 19 and 30 million tons. So a lot of material going down. Not all storms are the same. So Irene and Lee caused a lot of problems, but not Sandy, because the rain wasn't intense enough, because it happened later in the year. So you certainly have to take care of the seasonal timing. But so it's not always the largest storms that can cause the biggest problems, like I said before. There could be other factors that come into play. And I'll give you this example that we just monitored this, we just sampled this earlier in 2016, and I've submitted a paper on this for, it's in review. Freeze-thaw conditions. So how would freeze-thaw conditions affect sediment transport and water quality? This is how it does, especially in areas with mill pond legacy sediments. So if you have these stream banks, which are 3 feet to 10 feet high, and I didn't show you something really interesting. We might have it in the next picture. So this is a picture from our watershed site. And at this site, it's not very apparent in this picture, and I think it was apparent in the previous picture, but that pre-colonial sediment layer, that black horizon, is sitting right here. So this is where that black horizon is there. So that was the horizon 300 years before. And this is, all this is the legacy sediment. This light colored sediment is all that sediment that eroded off the agricultural fields and is now sitting near the stream. This is the fine grained legacy sediment. And this is the sediment that erodes very quickly. So how does freeze-thaw come into play? So I took these pictures in 2016, February 2016. And just before that, before and after that polar vortex that came down. I think I took this picture around February 14th or 13th or so. We had that polar vortex coming down in the first week of February. It was extremely cold. What happened was that freezing conditions caused all this rubble that is forming on the banks. What it's doing is the soils on the sediments on the banks are saturated with water. They have moisture in it. When that cold front comes in, when the freezing occurs, what happens to water? It freezes, it becomes ice, it expands. So the pore water that's in the sediments is expanding. And when that water expands, it's pushing out the sediment. And that's what is happening. All these banks along the tributaries, all along the river, are turning into this mushy soil sitting right on the banks. So what you're doing is you're converting this stable bank into this mushy surface. Why? Because of this freeze thaw activity. The water converting to ice and pushing that sediment out. So what happened was before this storm event that happened, there was a storm event that happened on Feb 16th and Feb 24th. The bank turned to this. And after the rainfall event, this is what the surface looked like. So essentially, all that sediment that's sitting up there got washed out into the creek and down the stream. And I'll show you a picture after this of how the streams looked like. It was amazing. So all this freeze-thaw activity has loosened up this legacy sediments, the stream bank, the mill pond sediments, and it's washing it out. And this mass is quite a bit. It's not a small amount. Just imagine this surface for miles and miles of those creeks. So what do the creeks look like? So what happened was, there was a unique condition. I'm gonna make sure I'm on time here. The other interesting part was, again, I think this is linked to some extent with climate change. So this occurred in early February of 2016. On February 2016 was the warmest winter on record globally. But we had these large polar vortex coming down, so that those were creating the cold snaps. But because of the warm winter, we also got some rain events, very intense rain events, especially in Deleware. And I'm sure it happened elsewhere also. So instead of snow coming down in February, we were getting these very intense rain events. So there was one event on February 16th, extremely intense, 1 inch of rainfall in 1 hour. And it was like crazy. I was like, this is not what's supposed to happen in February. 1 inch of rainfall in 1 hour, we're supposed to get snow. This should be coming down as snow. Instead of snow and instead of light rain, I'm getting this very intense rain. So I was sitting in my office, and fortunately it happened at noontime. So I was sitting in my office and this heavy rain comes down. 1 inch of rainfall in 1 hour. I was like, I cannot sit in the office. I need to get out to my field site and see what's happening. I didn't expect this, but this is what I see. So there's the creeks, all over the creeks, all the creeks around there are chocolate colored. They're moving tons and tons of sediment with the creeks. I didn't expect this at all. I was like, I went out there and I'm like, this is crazy. I don't even see this much sediment during the summer, during the intense storms. Why is this, there's so much of sediment? So I did collect some samples and we analyzed them. There's 1400 milligrams per liter of sediment moving through that creek at that flow, at that specific flow. Typically, we generally are, even in the highest rain, like Irene, we get to about 200, 300 milligram per liter. And here we are at 1400 milligram per liter. Why? Blame it on freeze thaw. All that sediment that's loosened up out there in February, that intense rain event came down, it just washed the banks. It just cleaned the banks for all the miles and miles of the tributaries. And this is what you get. I couldn't believe it. So I was like, this is one of my small streams. Maybe it's happening at the small scale. I said, I didn't have the data, the suspended sediment data for the large streams, but fortunately for us, USGS, US Geological Survey, has turbidity data, continuous turbidity sensors sitting in these large streams. And that's what I went to. And so I went to some of these USGS gauge stations on some of the large streams in our vicinity. And I looked at the turbidity data. And it's pretty neat. And that's why we need to keep the USGS funded. They had data for some of the locations for the past 10 years at every 15 minutes. So they have turbidity data for these streams for the past 10 years. So I said, let me just take a look at all the data. So I plotted the turbidity data. And turbidity data is a very good surrogate or proxy for suspended sediment. There's a very strong relationship between the two. So you can use the turbidity data to get suspended sediment concentrations. There's a very strong proxy there. So I plotted the data. There's the stream discharge. There's the river discharge from Brandywine Creek. You're looking at 314 square miles. So very large stream that's draining. And it also, so there's the February event.
there's a large 2014 events. There's Sandy, there's Tropical Storm Lee, and some other tropical storms. But look at that February event. So I said, I knew the concentrations were very high. I said, let me compute the mass, the total amount that was moving. Because you just can't look at the concentrations. You have to look at the total amount that's moving in the creek. So what you do, how do you measure the amount? You multiply the concentrations times the discharge. That gives you the total mass. So what I found was these February events were moving, again, nearly half the annual sediment load, and way more than the amount generated by Irene or some of these other hurricanes or large storms. So that's my point. Don't just look at the very large storm events, because you could get conditions like this, which you totally didn't expect, which would generate very high concentrations. So this is a big, big concern right now. We have a new project that just got funded by USDA to study how freeze thaw conditions can loosen up the banks and flush this sediments with these large events. And we are going to get more of these large events, and also the intense rainfalls during February, because our climate is warming, our winters are going to be more warmer. So how do we deal with this? What are the management strategies that we deal with these situations? And I don't have all the answers here, but I'm going to mention some of them here. This is a picture of a project that's trying to stabilize some of the stream banks. So how do we deal with these large events, this combination of these events that could generate a lot of sediment and nutrients and cause water quality problems? One of the most obvious common sense thing is we need to reduce the supply. We just can't be putting out nutrients out there, animal manure out there with very high phosphorus and continuously saturating our landscape. And I'm just taking manure and nutrients as an example, but it could be any other pollutant that you're dealing with. So we need to reduce the supply. That's the best way to do it. First of all, try to reduce the supply, the amount of nutrients that are out there. For with regard to legacy sediments, those stream banks that are out there, vertical stream banks that are eroding, we need to do some stream bank stabilization and restoration. But this topic is extremely controversial right now. There are two different, many groups of scientists putting forth different restoration strategies. Like, for example, what Dorothy Meritz and Bob Walter, who actually discovered the legacy sediments, what they say is we need to dig out the legacy sediments, because that's not the natural state. We need to completely dig out the legacy sediments and put them back onto the fields, but that's extremely expensive. You know, you can't be digging out miles and miles and miles of sediments, because that's the situation in the Mid-Atlantic and the Northeast. Our creeks are loaded with these sediments on the banks. You cannot dig them out. It's extremely expensive. They actually recently did a project where they did dig it out. So they converted these steep banks to back to their pre-colonial situation by moving all the sediments out. That was expensive, but I think that's what they are propagating. Most of the other scientists are not in that group. They're like, no, we can't do that. We can't be digging out our legacy sediments because it's extremely expensive, and where are we going to put it? So this aspect is extremely still controversial. We certainly need to reduce the supply, and we need to be prepared for the transport, the amount of water that's moving with these large events, the amount of erosive energy that is there. Because of the changing climate, because of the changing magnitude of these storm events and the frequency, and the conditions, the coupled conditions that they are going to occur under, we need to start redesigning our management practices. Like, for example, I'll give an example of in Vermont, when Irene happened, it busted a lot of the road culverts, because those road culverts were not designed to take the flood. So now they're redesigning some of the culverts so that large flood that will happen, those culverts can handle it. So in the same way, the management practices that we are implementing, we need to go from this old regime with smaller storms to a new regime with larger storms, which can handle more flow, more nutrients,
more sediment. So we'll have to change the way we are doing things in terms of management. And again, there's no solution here, but this is just something we need to think about. This was again a very controversial issue in the conference that we had in Puerto Rico, where we discussed the challenges associated with extreme events. Is how do we come up with management practices that can handle a changing climate regime? This is one other aspect that we still need to think about, especially in terms of legacy sediment. Why? Because this is the new trend that's happening in the Northeast, Mid-Atlantic, even out west, is we are removing our dams, particularly mill dams. So most of the mill dams are gone. They're breached because they were 100, 200 years old. So the mill dams peaked in their implementation. So 1800s, 1700s and 1800s was the time when most of the mill dams went in. And since then, most have breached, but there are still some mill dams out there. And now what we're doing is we are removing those mill dams for fish habitat. And that's a good thing, you know. Yeah, we need to improve the fish. You know, we need to move or take the stream back to its original condition. To improve the fish habitat so that fish can move upstream, you need to remove the mill dam. But we need to account for the sediments that are sitting behind it. Because if you remove all the mill dams and you remove them quickly, those sediments are going to be out there, vulnerable, exposed, and with freeze-thaw conditions and other such conditions, they're going to erode. And that those sediments are going to come into the creek and down they go to the Chesapeake Bay. So the big concern now in the Chesapeake Bay is, are these legacy sediments undercutting the management practices that we are putting on uplands to control agricultural erosion? So that's the big, the $1 million or $1 billion question in the Chesapeake Bay. What do we do with these legacy sediments? They are sitting right by the creek. They don't even have to travel longer distances. So if these legacy sediments erode and move down the creek to the Chesapeake Bay, all the BMPs that we put up there in the urban landscape, in the agricultural landscape, the buffer strips, the filter strips, the green design in urban areas, all that is going to be of no value because the legacy sediments are going to straight find the easiest way into the stream. So that's one of the big questions. So just to conclude here, so extreme weather events and large storms are going to create a challenge. They're going to increase the transport capacity. We already have a lot of supply of sediments and nutrients sitting on the landscape. These large storms are going to move it. And that's why we need to study these large events more closely. We need to do more monitoring. We need to have these sensors sitting out there collecting data for these large events when we cannot go out there during these very large storms. We need to reduce the supplies on the landscape, and we obviously need to do a better job in designing our management practices. With that, I'll stop here because I'm pretty much running out of time.